Good morning.
Good morning.
And welcome to Shepherd of the Hills.
There are a lot of charlatan preachers out there who preach only about money in order to make their pockets fatter and richer, which paradoxically means that a lot of churches don't want to talk about money because they don't want to seem like them. But at the same time, it means that we must talk about money in order to set the record straight. Today we're going to set the record straight. As we look at what the Bible actually says about money and the connection that the gospel has to what we do. Our opening hymn is printed for us in our bulletins. It is hymn 245 from the old hymnal. We're going to be singing God Loved the World So That He Gave. The men's choir will sing stanzas 1 through 4, and then we ask that everyone would join in singing stanzas 5 together. May God bless you.
Holy and merciful Father, I confess that I am by nature sinful.
I deserve your punishment, both now and in eternity. But I am truly sorry for my sins, and trusting in my Savior Jesus Christ, I pray, Lord, have mercy on me, a sinner.
Well, we put it, you knew put it in there, right?
Where does it go off that?
to help the church. Yeah, it goes to help the church. It goes to pay Pastor Gregory. It goes to help poor people. It goes to share Jesus with other people. It goes to buy Sunday school materials. It goes to help people all around the world. Did you know that some of the money that we give to our church ends up in places like Africa and Russia and China? It pays for people to share Jesus with others. That's pretty cool. To think that a quarter that you give or a dollar that you give is actually helping people to learn about Jesus. Now here's a very important question. Why do people give money to the church? Why would we do that?
Because it also brings people comfort.
That's actually not the main reason. The main reason we give to the church is because we want to thank God for all that He's done for us. Can you think of some things that God has done for us? The big one is He died on the cross, right? Jesus died on the cross, and He had to do that to take away our sins. So that one day when we die, we're going to go where? To heaven. So that's the main reason we want to give thanks to God, is because He paid for our sins. What else does God do for us?
He gives us mom and dad.
He gives us mom and dad, grandma and grandma, aunts and uncles, cousins and brothers and sisters, friends and family. He gives us a lot of different people in our lives. What else does God do for us? What about, is it lunch today? Does that come from God? Yeah. God gives us plants and animals. He gives us the sun and the rain. He provides all that we need. Does God do anything else for us?
Yeah.
What? He made us. God created us. That's something we can be thankful for, right? God gives us life. Does God watch over us?
Yeah.
Does He protect us?
Yeah.
He protects us. He does all kinds of things for us. And so we want to give thanks to Him. We give thanks to Him by praying to Him, by worshiping Him. Yep. We give thanks to Him by coming to church. He gives us clothes, right? And another way that we give thanks is by giving money to our church so that many more people can learn about everything that God does for us. So today, when the offering plate comes by and you see these envelopes in there, you see some money in there, I want you to think about what that money is being used for. It's being used to spread the gospel. And I want you to think about why we give, because God loves you so much. Thanks for coming out. You can go back to your seats.
Structure is not for man, but for the Lord God. With all my resources, I have provided for the temple of my God. Gold for the gold work, silver for the silver, bronze for the bronze, iron for the iron, and wood for the wood, as well as onyx for the settings, turquoise, stones of various colors, and all kinds of fine stone and marble, all of these in large quantities. Besides in my devotion to the temple of my God, I now give my personal treasures of gold and silver for the temple of my God, over and above everything I have provided for this holy temple. 3,000 talents of gold of Ophir, and 7,000 talents of refined silver for the overlaying of the walls and the buildings, for the gold work and the silver work, and for all the work to be done by the craftsmen. Now, who is willing to consecrate himself today to the Lord? Then the leaders of families, the officers of the tribes of Israel, the commanders of thousands and commanders of hundreds, and the officials in charge of the king's work, they gave toward the work of the temple of God 5,000 talents and 10,000 derricks of gold, 10,000 talents of silver, 18,000 talents of bronze, and 100,000 talents of iron. Any who had precious stones gave them to the treasury of the temple of the Lord in the custody of Jehiel the Gershonite. The people rejoiced at the willing response of their leaders, for they had given freely and wholeheartedly to the Lord. David the king also rejoiced greatly. David praised the Lord in the presence of the whole assembly, saying, "Praise be to you, O Lord, God of our father Israel, from everlasting to everlasting. Yours, O Lord, is the greatness and the power and the glory and the majesty and the splendor. For everything in heaven and earth is yours. Yours, O Lord, is the kingdom. You are exalted as head over all. Wealth and honor come from you. You are the ruler of all things. In your hands are strength and power to exalt and give strength to all. Now, our God, we give you thanks and praise for glorious name. But who am I? And who are my people, that we should be able to give as generously as this? Everything comes from you, and we should have given you only what comes from your hand. We are aliens and strangers in your sight, as were all our forefathers. Our days on earth are like a shadow without hope. O Lord our God, as for all this abundance that we have provided for building you a temple for your holy name, it comes from your hand, and all of it belongs to you. I know, my God, that you test the heart and are pleased with integrity. Things I have given willingly and with honest intent, and now I have seen with joy how willingly your people who are here have given to you. O Lord, God of our forefathers, Abraham, Isaac, and Israel, keep this desire in the hearts of your people forever, and keep their hearts loyal to you. I give my son Solomon the wholehearted devotion to keep your commands, requirements, and decrees, and to do everything to build the palatial structure for which I have provided. Then David said to the whole assembly, "Praise the Lord your God." So they all praised the Lord, the God of their fathers. They bowed low and fell prostrate before the Lord and the king. This is God's holy word. Our second lesson is from the Epistle to the Corinthians, 2 Corinthians chapter 9, verses 6 through 14. When you get down to it, you and I are rich. God has blessed us with so much. What are we to do with all the blessings that God has given to us? Well, we don't keep them to ourselves selfishly, but we give the gifts that God has given to us. Let's read from 2 Corinthians. This is what I mean. The one who sows sparingly will also reap sparingly. The one who sows generously will also reap generously. Each one should give as he has determined in his heart, not reluctantly or under pressure, for God loves a cheerful giver. God is able to make all grace overflow to you, so that in all things, at all times, having all that you need, you will overflow in every good work. As it is written, "He scattered, he gave to the poor, his righteousness remains forever." And he who provides seed to the sower and bread for food will provide and multiply your seed for sowing, and will increase the harvest of your righteousness. You will be made rich in every way, so that you may be generous in every way, which produces thanksgiving to God through us. To be sure, the administration of this service is not only making up for what is lacking among the saints, but it is also overflowing in many prayers of thanksgiving to God. By proving yourselves in the service, many people are glorifying God as they see the obedience shown in your confession of the gospel of Christ and the generosity shown in your sharing with them and all people. At the same time, as they pray for you, they also express their longing for you because of the extraordinary measure of God's grace given to you. Thanks be to God for his indescribable gift. This is God's word. Please stand. The Gospel according to Luke, chapter 14, verses 7 through 14. The world strives and fights for so much honor, fame, power, and authority. Don't be like the world. Instead, follow the example of Christ, who became poor so that we might become rich in the forgiveness of sins. We read from our Gospel. When he noticed how they were selecting the places of honor, he told the invited guests a parable. When you are invited by someone to a wedding banquet, do not recline in the place of honor, or perhaps someone more distinguished than you may have been invited by him. The one who invited both of you may come and tell you, "Give this man your place." Then you will begin with shame to take the lowest place. But when you are invited, go and recline in the lowest place, so that when the one who invited you comes, he will tell you, "Friend, move up to a higher place." Then you will have honor in the presence of all who are reclining at the table with you. Yes, everyone who exalts himself will be humbled, and whoever humbles himself will be exalted. He also said to the one who had invited him, "When you make a dinner or a supper, do not invite your friends or your brothers or your relatives or rich neighbors, so that perhaps they may also return the favor and pay you back. But when you make a feast, invite the poor, the crippled, the lame, the blind, and you will be blessed because they cannot repay you. Certainly, you will be repaid in the resurrection of the righteous." This is the Gospel of our Lord. Let's now confess our faith together using the words of the Apostles' Creed.
I believe in God the Father Almighty, Maker of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From there he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Christian Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
Please be seated as we sing the hymn of the day, hymn 443, "Rejoice My Heart, Be Glad and Sing."
grace, mercy, and peace are yours
through faith in our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Amen. The words that we are meditating upon this morning are our Old Testament lesson from 1 Chronicles chapter 29. We brothers and sisters. Not many of you were around when our church was formed some 43 years ago now. A couple of you were here 25 years ago when our church expanded to include the worship place that we are now in. Building projects are always exciting. When you look at our history of our church, you can see the times of growth and expansion and confidence as God works among that little group of people. And now look at us. Our little group isn't so little anymore, is it? God has blessed us tremendously. In our Old Testament lesson, David was embarking on a building project to build the temple of the Lord in Jerusalem. The words that we hear from David show us an example of what it means to be joyful in our generosity. As we see David and the people of Israel be joyful and generous, may our prayer be that we would have that same attitude of thanks for God's undeserved love. Now, King David was not a perfect person. His sins are pretty memorable. But here's one you may not have known. When David was near the end of his reign, he did a very foolish and sinful thing by selfishly trusting in his own power and in the might of his army. So God disciplined David by sending a plague among the people. David, in repentance, built an altar to God and offered a sacrifice to God upon that altar. The substitution of the animal sacrifice satisfied God's anger, and God took away that plague of death. Now, David made that sacrifice on the threshing floor of a man named Arauna. That piece of ground would later become the site of the temple in Jerusalem. When David asked to buy that property from Arauna, he offered to give it to him for free. But David said to him, "No, I insist on paying you. I will not sacrifice the Lord my God burnt offerings that cost me nothing." In other words, David said, how is it a sacrifice if I don't have to sacrifice anything, if it costs me nothing? Where would be the joyful generosity in that? It's easy to be generous when it doesn't cost us anything. Have you ever dreamed about winning the lottery and how generous you would be with all the money that you get? I know I've thought about it. In my dreams, I think about how fun it would be just to buy the church's expansion, and how fun it would be to fund Wells Missions across the world, to give a big gift to the endowment fund for MLS, to just pay for all of the schooling for future pastors and teachers. Those daydreams kind of make me feel good. But is it joyful generosity if it's not real? Is it joyful generosity if it actually doesn't cost me anything? Our sermon text comes when David was planning to build a temple on the land that he had just purchased. The people of God were excited. They didn't hope that someone else would come in and just make it happen. But they welcomed the opportunity to experience that joyful generosity. And it was truly generous. When David made his personal gift to God's temple, something that he actually just gave his entire wealth to the temple, he gave 3,000 talents of gold, 10,000 That's 110 tons of gold and 260 tons of silver. All right, well, what's that? That's about $5 billion that he decided, I'm just going to get it. What made David so generous? And here's really the theme and the important part today. Joyful generosity is driven by the gospel. The words of David's prayer reveal that motivation for his giving. First, David recognizes that he isn't something, he's only giving something back that the Lord's actually already given to him. David's only giving something back, giving thanks. God had made him king. God had made him wealthy. God gave him 110 tons of gold and 206 tons of silver. It all belonged to God. But David could have fun using that money to God's glory. Giving to the Lord was fun for David because David's heart was responding to God's undeserved love for him. He says, "Who am I? Who are my people that we should be able to give as generously as this? Everything comes from you, and we've only given you what comes from your hand. We are aliens and strangers in your sight. As for all our forefathers, our days are like a shadow without hope. O Lord our God, as for all this abundance that we have provided for building you a temple for your holy name, it comes from your hand and all that belongs to you." Who am I? David asks. Where would David be without the grace of God? Do you remember what grace means? Grace is God's undeserved love. It's God's intervention. It's his undeserved action in Jesus Christ to save sinners. Without God's grace, David would still be shepherding flocks because the youngest son really never got to be his own boss. Where would David be without God's intervention? He would still be the adulterer who stole Bathsheba from one of King David's faithful soldiers and then murdered him by putting him on the front lines of battle to be killed. God intervened, sending the prophet Nathan to bring him repentance. David explains what it was like when he was apart from God in Psalm 32. He tells us, "When I was silent, my bones wasted away as I groaned all day long. For day and night your hand was heavy upon me. My moisture was dried up by the droughts of summer." David would have remained in unbelief and sin, in the dark despair, with no hope of rescue. He would have had nothing. He would have been nothing. On his own, he would have had no present. He would have had no future. But God intervened by his grace. Where would you be without God's grace? The answer is that you would have been in the same place that David was, where millions of people around you are right now. You and I would be living in the darkness of unbelief, the despair of sin. You and I would be trying to be somebody by making a name for ourselves. You'd be checking Facebook and Instagram and Snapchat to see how many likes you got from someone today. You've been looking back on all of your sins that you've committed with no relief for a guilty conscience. You would come to the end of your life terrified because you didn't know what was about to happen. Or if you did know what was about to happen, you would be even more terrified. Because there you would stand alone without anyone picking you up. But God intervened. He called you to faith in Jesus. It happened with gracious waters of baptism. There, God gave you a confidence that you didn't deserve. His word strengthens and keeps you in his grace. You have peace with God. Your sins are forgiven, and you have it all in Christ Jesus. You are now one who is loved. And you know what your future holds. On top of that, you and I know how to give thanks through our worship and our praise. You and I know what to do with all the stuff that God gives to us.
how much you actually have.
Listen to what Jesus tells his disciples. Do not be afraid, little flock, for your Father is pleased to give you the kingdom. What kingdom is Jesus talking about? God has given to you the kingdom of his grace, his heavenly kingdom. He has made you to be kings and priests in his kingdom. Jesus has taken away your guilt and your despair, and in his place, he replaces it with the joy of being his child. He's redeemed you, and he's made you his own. And now there's nothing that Jesus withholds from you. He's even filled our purses with gold and silver and invites us to have fun with it. All to his glory. What does that look like, to have fun in joyful generosity? Well, there are actually a lot of options that God has opened up to us. We got our regular offerings to support a congregation and the proclamation of the gospel in this place. There are many charities which we can give to, maybe one of our wells, missions. There are endowment funds. There are scholarship funds. God has opened up so many opportunities to have fun with the things that he has given us as we thank him for all that he's given us. Yet our joyful generosity goes on way beyond what's just church-related. Food pantries and community activities, disaster relief, not to mention the love and the support that we give to all loved ones. These are all fun ways to give God glory with the treasures that God himself has provided. The generosity of God's grace opens up a well of joyful generosity in our own hearts. Joyful generosity responds to God's grace by saying with King David, "Who am I? Who are my people that I should be able to give as generously as this? Everything comes from you, and we have given you only what comes from your hand." Our Christian giving prioritizes God's kingdom, but our motivation is the most important thing. Motivation is more important than the amount that we give. David says this in his prayer, "I know, my God, that you test the heart and are pleased with integrity. All these things I have given willingly and with honest intent, and now I have seen with joy how willingly your people who are here have given to you. O Lord God, our fathers, Abraham, Isaac, and Israel, keep this desire in the hearts of your people forever, and keep their hearts loyal to you." See, that David didn't talk about how much people gave, but why they gave. They gave with integrity, with a single-minded devotion for the gospel. May God always keep that desire in the hearts of his people today and in the future generations to come until the Lord returns. Did you know that Jesus never worshipped in Solomon and King David's temple? It was destroyed. But it was rebuilt in part by King Herod. This was the same Herod who wanted to kill baby Jesus, who slaughtered the infants in Bethlehem. He didn't believe in or serve the Lord. Yet, Herod had given a lot of money to build his temple. Why did he do that? Well, he wanted to buy political favor. He wanted to receive honor and praise for himself. His generosity was selfish and self-serving. It was not pleasing to God because it did not come from a heart of faith. David's gift for the temple, along with the gifts of God's people, were different. They were given from trusting hearts. They were given willingly and with honest intent. They were given in joy and generosity. David would actually never reap the benefits of his generosity in his lifetime. He would never walk into the brand new temple, and he would never gaze upon the beauty of what he had planned to build. And yet, he wrote a psalm for its dedication, Psalm 33. How often do you think about what David, how often do you think David ponders what it was going to be like when that temple was worshipped for the first time? He must have imagined what it would have been like to see it completed when he wrote in my favorite psalm, Psalm 27, "One thing I ask from the Lord, this only do I seek, that I may dwell in the house of the Lord all the days of my life, to gaze on the beauty of the Lord and to seek him in his temple." If David wouldn't get anything personal out of the gift that he gave to the Lord, why did he give? Well, he was motivated by God's grace. He wanted to give thanks. So he did. In addition, David was providing for the future of his church. David knew that God's house would be a place where the truth of the gospel would be proclaimed for future generations. He wanted his son Solomon and his son's sons and his great-great-grandchildren to have a place to grow up in the Lord. David wanted a place where the people would come to learn of the only true God. He wanted future generations to gaze upon the beauty of the Lord and to find comfort in the promise that God was going to send a Savior. We give to the Lord's work because we just have to give thanks to God for his grace. It's gospel motivated. Even if we never see any benefit from our gifts, wouldn't they still flow from our heart of faith? Another lesson that God gives us is that he actually does allow us to see the fruits of our giving. We see it in our own congregation. We see it as we support pastors and teachers in our synod. We see it as we hear reports from missionaries across the world. We see it as we support Emmanuel in their education efforts at MLS. We see it here in Sunday school, in confirmation class, so that children learn about Jesus and study his word. While buildings are important, we don't give to buildings. We give to the Lord. We want the next generation to have Christian faith, that we're all strong in it. And it's the gospel that moves us to be generous. It's the gospel that brings us so much joy. How will the Lord use the gifts that we give today and in our lifetimes? How will the Lord use these gifts as we have a spirit of joyful generosity? I have no idea. But I know that it will be fun. The peace of God, which transcends understanding, will guard your hearts and minds through faith in Christ Jesus. Amen. Please stand, and let's join with you, David, in singing a portion of Psalm 51, The Create in Me, which is on page 8 in our bulletin.
Thank you.
sacraments, for opportunities to worship and to grow in faith and knowledge, for occasions to serve and be served, for fellowship with believers in our congregation and in our synod.
Help us to rejoice in these blessings, dear Lord, and to use them faithfully.
Jesus Christ, Lord of the Church, you give grace to your people by calling us to be your witnesses in the world. Open our eyes to see the great and noble mission that lies before us. In the hurting eyes of the lonely, in the pained eyes of the sick, and in the searching eyes of the lost, help us to see your face, O Jesus, and to serve others as we would serve you.
Awaken us to the opportunities you give to proclaim your message of love.
Holy Spirit, giver of life, through word and sacrament bestow on us the wisdom and power we need to witness clearly and to act boldly. Help us to speak the truth in love, to give the reason for the hope we have, and to conduct ourselves with gentleness and respect.
Set our hearts on fire as we work and witness for Christ.
Hear us, Lord, as we pray for a family member, an acquaintance, a neighbor, or a friend who does not believe in you or whose faith is weak or troubled. Bless the church with men and women who are willing to proclaim your word in places where we cannot go. Keep them and their loved ones in your care, and let nothing hinder their work. By the power of the gospel, restore their spirits each day, so that they do not lose heart as they serve us and others.
Move us to support them with our sincere prayers and generous offerings.
Dear Lord, we ask you to be with and to give comfort to the family and friends of Linda Ellison, the aunt of the Wookiee family who are grieving her loss after many years of battling cancer. We also ask you to bring comfort to the family and friends of Ernie Irometti, mother of Kim Ford, who are grieving her loss. Lord, we ask you to watch over and take care of Mike McBride, nephew of Mary Boulder, who is experiencing health complications, with Ann Ashbaugh, who continues to struggle with health complications due to her cancer. And Father, Lord, we ask you to give safe travel to Doug Tabor, who travels to Malawi this week with the Kingdom Workers on a mission trip, and also to our teens and chaperones who will be helping our mission congregation in LaPorte, Indiana, next weekend. Wherever your word is proclaimed, O Lord, grant it success. Let your kingdom come to us and others, so that we, and many more, might join the assembly of saints and angels to sing your praise forever.
Savior of all, hear our prayer,
and help us in our mission. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven.
Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
Bless, Lord, you have given us our Holy Scriptures for our salvation. May we so hear them, read, learn, and take them to heart, that being strengthened and comforted by your Holy Word, we may cling to the blessed hope of everlasting life, through Jesus Christ our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine on you and be gracious to you. The Lord look on you with his favor and give you peace. Thank you. continue with our midweek Lenten worship this Wednesday at 7 p.m. with Pastor Mark Eckert from Calvary Eden Rapids. Don't also forget that there is a potluck dinner beforehand at 5:45. This week's dinner is going to be in Italian. Please sign up to bring needed items in those green sheets out on the bulletin board in the office. Next Sunday, there's going to be a short presentation about 4 to 5 minutes after each of the services. And the purpose of this presentation is just to update everyone where we're at with the building program. And the second part is, if you're like me, my age and younger, you don't write checks anymore, and you don't carry cash. So, how do they give an offering? So our church is now equipped to handle the credit cards and transfers from the bank. So, we'll give information about how to do that. There's an app for your phone. It's great. Next page. The fourth session of the parent discussion is going to be Sunday, March 25th, after the late service. Please sign up on the sheet from the Narthex if you're planning to attend that. On that day, the Sunday school kids are also singing in the 10:30 service. That's Palm Sunday. After this service here, if I can get a couple people with some strong backs to help set up the tables and chairs in the fellowship hall for that Lenten supper and dinner, that would be great. Just head right back there after church here and hands make light work. Pastor, are you doing awesome?
Yeah, our team mission trip is next weekend, Saturday the 17th, and also Sunday the 18th. Thanks to Tim Daniels and Pam Richards for being our chaperones. Parents, if your kids are going, come up to the front and get your medical release form and some information about the trip.
Did you bring any out?
Oh, yes.
Letters to?
Yes. Yeah, some letters about the rollout of our plan to achieve our facility expansion. Those are going to be given to you by our ushers on the way out.
So we're in the third week. We just finished the third week of our stewardship series. So there's one more week to go. Next week in our worship, in our Bible studies, we're going to take a look at how do you determine like how much offering to get? What's up with tithing and everything like that? So we're going to take a look at what God's Word actually says about that next week. That'll finish up our stewardship series. One quick other announcement before we rush fellowship, or before I rush the Wells Convention. I don't think I've said it in a couple of months now, but it's just great to have so many kids come up, and it's a joy to be able to see their joy when they're up here. I know some of you in the back probably can't see it very well, but they get so excited about telling me that Jesus died for their sins. And they tell it to me as if I've never heard it before. But that's what's so cool, is that they're so happy to do that. So keep bringing your kids to church, and I know that's not always easy to do, but I'm glad you're making it. Let's watch our most action.
Our schools are growing. the crazy. Our schools are just multiplying, and especially in the South, in Texas, and Florida. And we don't have the teachers for that.
Martin Luther College has stepped up efforts to prepare students to serve in these settings, adding new coursework and offering practical experience. Student Phil Dieselhorst, for example, is serving a year-long teaching internship at New Hope. He still has two more years at Martin Luther College remaining, but this experience is preparing him for real-world situations.
Are we super good, Jim?
I love kids, so I enjoy the kid that I have with different kids, and I get to actually do some teaching and the experience to handle the classroom, having kids understand the subject matter I'm teaching.
Mr. Dieselhorst serves in a lot of roles for his abilities as teachers, teacher's assistant, he's a substitute teacher, the coordinator of the before and after care programs.
What's especially exciting about these growing schools is they often attract people from outside of the Bells, and at New Hope, many of those families become members.
Even though we do have a lot of children that are members of our church, almost all of those children did not begin their lives as well as members. People who knew about the true saving message of God.
The key to any school ministry is well-trained, loving, enthusiastic teachers. People like recent NLC graduate Katie Winter, who was overcome with joy when she first received her first call.
So I was listening, and then they said Florida, and I started bawling and crying out of thankfulness because I was so excited to go on this new journey somewhere.
Katie grew up in a small farming town, but Martin Luther College prepared her for the transition to urban ministry.
Once you get here, and once you get to the urban setting, you just realize these are kids, and these are kids that need to know God's word.
The settings may change, but the focus of our schools has not. Preparing young people for a world with Jesus at the center.
Contributing to the shortage of teachers is the demographic reality that a large number of our teachers are not reaching retirement age. So if you know of a young person who seems to have a heart and the gifts for teaching, do encourage them, because every Wells teacher can point to someone, like you, who gave them that nudge of encouragement.